Hello and welcome to the episode 104 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, the Beatles meet the Rolling Stones for the first time. They complete the recording of Paperback Writer, and John and Paul record the band's first stereo single. On the 14th of April 1961, the Beatles, featuring Pete Best on drums, had a night-long performance at the Top 10 Club in Hamburg, West Germany, for their second residency in that town. Moving on 1 year, in 1962, very little had changed. The Beatles still featured Pete Best on drums. They were still busy with the residency, still in Hamburg, and Hamburg was still in West Germany. The only difference, it seems, was the venue. This time around, it was the prestigious Star Club. On this date in 1963, we get another television appearance for the Beatles. This time, they were busy at the ABC Television Studio Center in Teddington, with their third appearance on Thank Your Lucky Stars. The result of today's filming was broadcast on the 20th of April, from 5:50 to 6:30 p.m. The session had started at 11 a.m. with the rehearsals of the show, in which the Beatles were third in a bill also featuring the not-yet-famous Dave Clark 5, the Vernon Girls, Bert Whedon, and the American artist Del Shannon. The Fabs mimed the performance of their third single, From Me to You. At the end of the shooting, having a rare night off, the Beatles decided to drive to the Crow Daddy Club in the Richmond-upon-Thames Station Hotel to see the performance of an up-and-coming band, the Rolling Stones. In the anthology book, George Harrison is quoted saying that he thought their music was the kind of rough R&B that the Beatles were playing in their leather jacket days. The Rolling Stones made a good impression, and the two bands met and chatted a bit. They would have other chances to meet up in the following weeks, striking a good friendship. Moving on to 1964, the Beatles were at the Twickenham Film Studios, and then on Arlington Road, just outside the studios, to shoot a sequence that did not end up in the final cut of A Hard Day's Night. Stuck in the traffic, they are cursed by a passenger in another car. Their chauffeur was British comedian Frank Thornton. More filming in 1965, this time for Help. The Beatles were on Ailsa Avenue in Twickenham for the initial street sequence of the film, in which the four protagonists are brought to their four terraced houses on their Rolls-Royce. The shooting of their arrival took all morning. The afternoon shootings did not involve the Beatles, and so they had some time off. And if you fancy this podcast a bit, you can do worse with your time off than visiting www.simonmas.com/support to discover how you can lend me a hand and show me how fab you are. No donation is too small, no help is forgotten. Make the difference and allow me to put out even more music-related content for you to enjoy. Thank you! Let's conclude this episode with two studio sessions. The first one took place on the 14th of April 1966 at the EMI Studios in Abbey Road. Today, between 2:30 and 7:30 p.m, the Beatles completed Paperback Writer, with further overdubs, including the catchy falsetto counter melody, a bass part, the lead vocal part by Paul, and a couple of keyboard tracks. Then, after a 30-minute pause during which two mono mixes of the song were prepared, the band started working on the B-side of the single, Rain. The recording of this song was one of the first examples of how the sonic experiments of one song led to different recording procedures for the band. In the Complete Beatles Recording Sessions book, engineer Jeff Emerick explains, "One of the things we discovered when playing around with loops on Tomorrow Never Knows was that the texture and depth of certain instruments sounded really good when slowed down. With Rain, the Beatles played the rhythm track really fast, so that when the tape was played back at normal speed, everything would be much slower, changing the texture. Indeed, the band recorded the five takes of the basic track at a higher tempo and a higher key. John's lead vocals, instead, were recorded with a tape machine running slower. During the mixing session, the rhythm track was slowed down and the vocal track was sped up, with the whole song ending up in a G major tonality, but obtaining a different sound than it would have if everything had been recorded at a normal speed in that tonality. The session ended at 1:30 a.m. and the Beatles went home. Different story in 1969. With Ringo Starr busy with the filming of The Magic Christian and George Harrison somewhere out in the country, it was up to John Lennon and Paul McCartney to reconvene at the EMI studios with George Martin and Jeff Emerick to record a new Lennon song, The Ballad of John and Yoko, They're Gonna Crucify Me. The subtitle was going to be dropped before the song was released as a single, the first in the Beatles' history to be released in stereo. In fact, John sent out a memo to all Apple employees to downplay that line of the song, lest the old Bigger Than Jesus affair resurfaced. The session was important for many reasons. First of all, Ringo and George weren't even made aware of the booking until they actually listened to the completed song. Then, there was the return of the Martin Emerick production team behind the mixing desk, the first time since Emerick walked out on the Beatles in July 1968. But perhaps most importantly, it's interesting to note that the synergy between John and Paul was still very strong at this point. For all the nasty bickering and the business squabbles, the two were incredibly productive today, starting the recording at 2:30 p.m. and getting the completed mix of the track by 11 p.m. They were in a good mood and joked a bit while recording 11 takes of the rhythm track, with John on guitar and vocals and Paul on drums, and then quickly proceeded on the overdubs. Paul added bass, piano, backing vocals and maracas. John added two lead guitars and a percussive beat played on the back of his acoustic guitar. In all fairness, Mark Herzgard of The New Yorker, who also had the privilege to listen to the complete session, commented that he thought there was a forced, polite quality to the humor between John and Paul, which lacked the enthusiasm of the earlier sessions. It was as if they were pulling the punches to complete the song as soon as possible. The matter is also complicated by the musical quote that John put at the end of the song, coming straight from Lonesome Tears in My Eyes, a 1956 love song by Johnny Brunette and the Rock and Roll Trio about a broken-hearted singer who believed in his lover's lies. Both he and Paul knew the song very well, as it had been performed by the Beatles in their early days. Was this an accusation in disguise, or a way to lament the current state of the affair? Later on, with the relationships in the band further deteriorating and John forming the Ono Plastic Band, a biographical song such as The Ballad of John and Yoko would have probably been reserved for that outlet. But in April 1969, the only way John conceived to issue non-avant-garde music was through the Beatles. This concludes this episode of What a Fab Day. Tune in tomorrow to get a bit of frost. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.